Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Christ is risen. Alleluia. Christ is risen. I just want to keep shouting it from not the mountaintops, but my backyard here in Albany. Welcome to worship this Sunday, the second Sunday in the season of Easter. This service is brought to you by many of us united across the Synod to proclaim Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. I pray you find in this worship service a place for you, a place for you to stop and rest and to be in God's presence as we now join with me wherever you are. Proclaim, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light, and our salvation. Amen. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning, your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word, you created the world, pouring forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood, you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea, you led your people, Israel, from slavery into freedom. At the river, your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word, you claim us as daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise and servants of all. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life. And above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit and renew our lives with your forgiveness, grace, and love. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, with joy we celebrate the day of our Lord's resurrection. By the grace of Christ among us, enable us to show the power of the resurrection in all that we say and do. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Pastor Johanna, and these are my kids, Grace and Isaac. They're going to help us with the children's sermon this morning. We're members of St. Paul's Lutheran Church in Pittsburgh, but we are coming to you today from our own living room, which I think might be where you are right now, too, in your own living rooms. So, happy Easter. There's something we always say during Easter. When we say, Alleluia, Christ is risen, you respond, He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Ready? Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Good job. Today we're going to hear the second part of the Easter story. It's like just a little bit later after Jesus rose from the dead. And he had come to his disciples in the upper room and it was locked. This is kind of a cool story because the room is locked. And then all the disciples are in there except for one. And they're all super scared. And then guess who just showed up?
Who?
Guess.
Jesus.
Jesus just showed up right in that room. And they were like, oh my gosh, that's crazy. And Jesus said, peace be with you. He knew they were scared. So he said, peace be with you. And then they went and told their friend Thomas, who wasn't there, all about it. And Thomas was like, what do you think you would say if you were Thomas? Would you say, oh yeah, that seems realistic.
Yeah.
That definitely happened.
Yeah, that was what I would say.
You think so? Would you believe that right away?
No.
Yeah, I don't think I would either. I believe it now, but then I think I would have been with Thomas. I would have been like, really? That seems unlikely. I mean, I love the guy, but really? He appeared through locked doors? And Thomas, that's exactly what Thomas says. He says, unless I can see that he's got holes in his hands from where he was hanging on the cross and see that he has a cut in his side that I saw that they put there, I'm not going to believe that that was really Jesus. Well, sure enough, the very next week, they were all in that same upper room. And guess who showed up again?
Jesus
again. And Jesus says, hey, Thomas, you wanted to see it. Here it is. Go ahead and touch it. And Thomas, you know what he does? He doesn't even need to touch it. He says, oh, my Lord and my God. And he knows that it is Jesus. Now, sometimes people call Thomas a doubter. They say that he doubted that Jesus really rose from the dead. I don't like to think of him as a doubter. I like to think of him as someone who asks a lot of questions, who just wants to understand Jesus. Do you ask a lot of questions?
Yeah, I love getting answers.
I know. You want to learn, right? Do you like asking questions? Yeah, do you like asking questions? I bet you do. Kids ask a lot of questions, and that is A-okay. It's important to ask questions. So I wondered if you could ask Jesus any question at all. What would you ask?
I'd ask, How do we get a bar?
Okay, and I'm sure Jesus would have understood that. And Grace, what would you ask?
I would ask, can you please give me my own Barbie dream
house? You'd ask for a Barbie dream house? Yeah.
I asked for my own Barbie dream house.
Oh, you would ask four things. Well, I would ask things that, so that I would know more about Jesus. Joey, what would you ask Jesus?
I would ask for pooping inside.
Great. Well, here's what I want you to do, kids at home and kids right here too. I want you to think, if there's something that you want to know from Jesus, what would you ask? And then I want you to ask your pastor that question. And pastors, I don't want you to answer the questions. I want you just to sit in those questions and to remember that no question is too big or too hard for God. You can ask anything at all. So let's say a prayer, and we're just going to ask a lot of questions in our prayer, okay?
Okay.
So let's pray. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
How big are you?
How big are you?
How do you love so much?
How do you love so much?
Why am I the way I am?
Why am I the way I am?
Why are you the way you are?
Why are you the way you are?
How can I be the best I can be?
How can I be the best I can be?
And how are you going to help me?
And how are you going to help me?
We give you all these questions. And thank you for your love.
And thank you for your love.
Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for joining us this morning. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Bye.
Bye.
A reading from Acts. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 20th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jewish authorities, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to Thomas, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and through believing, you may have life in his name, the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace to you and peace from our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The setting is a room. The doors are locked. Night is falling. Inhabitants of the room are the disciples, minus Judas, who took his final bow a couple of days ago, and minus Thomas. The plot involves the death of a man named Jesus, leader of a new movement attempting to bring the reign of God into the world in new and understandable for some and confusing for others fashion. The disciples are huddled in fear of the Jews and authorities. They had heard earlier that morning that Jesus had been raised from the dead, but they had yet to see him themselves. As their quiet conversations around the events of the past few days and weeks and years gave way to the what next of life following the death of Jesus, he appeared to them. Not bothered by locked doors, the fact that these men had fled, or the continued fear that inhabited their hearts and minds, as well as their wonderings and questions. And he said to them, "Peace be with you." And note this, he showed these 10 disciples his hands and his side, and then John writes, they believed. They looked him in the eye. They heard his voice. They felt his real presence, but they didn't believe until he showed them the marks of death, hands nailed to the cross, and a side pierced by a sword from a soldier that yielded water and blood on that day we call Good Friday. Does this story raise any questions for you? Like, where had Jesus been all day? What was he doing? Whose house were the disciples staying at? And most importantly, why didn't they believe when they first saw him without him having to show them his hands and his side? And then he breathed on them, giving to them the Holy Spirit and speaking of sins being forgiven and retained. And as abruptly as he appeared, he left. This is really a Pentecost story. This is now you see me, now you don't, Jesus. And then he was gone. To where? Why? And how did he make that happen? There's no time to really begin asking the questions according to John's storyline, for it seems that just as soon as Jesus disappeared, he reappears 1 week later to the day. Same room, same place, same people, except that Thomas, gone missing a week ago, is now present. John doesn't tell us where he was or what he was doing or why he was missing or, frankly, why he shows up this night. He simply was there. And Jesus stood among them and said another time, "Peace be with you." Moving directly to Thomas, seemingly ignoring everyone else in the room, Jesus positions himself directly in front of him and says, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Place it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." And Thomas, without touching or seemingly moving or reacting, says simply yet profoundly, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus' response, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe." John goes on to tell us in his writing that Jesus did these and many other things in order that others might believe, and the story comes to an end, but not really, as you know. I was lying in bed one morning last week. It was around 5:05, having woken a bit early for some unknown reason, and I began to listen to the early morning sounds. A neighbor down the street on her way to work. An early motorcyclist heading south on 590, a block and a half from the house. The beagle who lives across the street being screamed at by the owner's teenage daughter because the dog had escaped once again. The wind blowing through the trees and the sound of the birds singing. Not a lot of birds, a few, perhaps 7 or 8, maybe a dozen, seemed to me, but enough to pierce the early morning air. I heard a cardinal, a couple of crows bantering back and forth, some other unidentifiable species chirping brightly in the small tree across the street from the house. I couldn't see them, but I heard them. I could not swear beyond a shadow of a doubt that they were out there if asked to do so in court, because I had not seen them. I hadn't. I had heard them. And I believed. I believed they were there, and more importantly, I believe that spring has begun to arrive with some intensity as the birds continue to return in greater numbers. Each morning at this time of the year, their numbers begin to increase, it seems. Soon a cacophony of song will fill the air, beginning around 4:30, waking me earlier than I want to be wakened. But I hear them and I know they are present, and hope of new life springs eternal. You and I, we have not seen, and yet we believe. We have heard the stories of Christ and his resurrection. We have studied the texts, listened to the sermons he preached, tried to understand his parables, and attempted to discern what this all means in our lives and our world, yet we have not seen. We have prayed our prayers, gathered at God's table, sung our favorite and not so favorite hymns in the past, and soon to sing them again, hopefully in the future. We have had a foretaste of the feast to come, yet we have not seen the physical Christ. We have shared the journey of faith with one another and others. We've struggled in moments of great doubt that sometimes stretch to weeks, asked questions of abandonment and hopelessness, and come back again and again to the source of resurrected life, yet we have not seen, and yet we believe. We believe because of the stories of John's gospel, or Matthew's, or Mark's, or Luke's. We have heard of Peter's witness to the faith in prison and out, as well as Paul's. We have read of Abraham, who set an example and who trusted and was blessed. I could go on and on. We have not seen, yet you and I believe. If Jesus appeared among us today, right now, at this moment in time, would that make a difference? How would that go? Peace be with you, he would say. I am the risen Christ. I'm guessing our response might be similar to Thomas's, wouldn't it? Unless I see and place my hands and touch the wounds. We believe because we have heard the stories passed for generations, from parents and grandparents and great-grandparents, from aunts and uncles and pastors and Sunday school teachers. We believe because we have witnessed the life of faith lived out in the lives of others who believe more mightily than we do at some times. We believe because the Spirit given in baptism moves in our midst, strengthening our faith and our hope and our life. It's the same Holy Spirit who calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies with his gifts and keeps us in the one true faith. If push came to shove, could we prove what we believe? No. No way. Have we found ourselves, when we've wondered at moments if this is all true, if it could really have happened, if God is really real? I know that I have. Perhaps you have too. Reflecting back on Thomas, we are him from time to time and day to day, are we not? We seek proof, yet we look in the wrong places. We search for God, only to discover that God has been searching for us. We ask questions which have no answers, only to reformulate them and ask them again. Jesus said, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed." He said that to Thomas in this gospel for this day. He says that to you and to me. He breaks through our locked doors. He destroys the barriers and walls that we build. He tears down our fears and concerns and failure. He stands in front of us this day in word and in sacrament, in prayer and in song, inviting us into his hands, his wounds, his life, and his resurrection and its blessings. Blessed are you, he says this day. Receive the gifts that he brings. Hear his voice of welcome clearly offered. See his unmistakable presence now, even in this place, in the place where you are, in all of the world, for all of God's children. May the peace of the risen Christ be yours. Amen.
The Lord calls us to draw close and examine the wounded hands and feet of the risen one, and to know the depth of his love for us. Let us therefore approach the throne of God in confidence, as we pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, and for all people according to their needs. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, as you entered the locked room to show your disciples the beginning of a new world, so enter our hearts and move us to faith in you, the risen one. Convince us of the reality and significance of the resurrection, and free us from all manner of fears and phobias. Give us courage in the face of death, knowing that this is the gateway to new, resurrected life for those who trust in Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Be with your church throughout the world, so that its preaching and works of love may continue to testify to your resurrection, wherever your church is faithless and lacking in courage to do the work that you have given. Visit and build it up with your Spirit. Be with all our pastors, so that they may listen well and then speak with your authority. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bring peace to all parts of the earth, wherever nations are at war and people are divided. Visit and bring true reconciliation. Help us end conflict, whether it is between ourselves and a neighbor, or our nation and another. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Wherever homes are disrupted by anger and bitterness, and wherever relationships are distorted and dulled, visit and bring peace and harmony. Wherever young people are gathered in your name, visit and guide them with your holy word and wisdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Visit and comfort the sick and suffering too, dear Lord. Heal and strengthen weak bodies. Calm and correct confused minds. We pray for those we know with particular needs and maladies, whether it be from disease or from dis-ease. Visit and bring healing. Support them all with your great love and mercy, and be with those others known to us and whom we now name in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we present these prayers through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is risen from the dead, and who lives and reigns with you and taught us all to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
May our glorious God grant you a spirit of wisdom to know and to love the risen Lord. The God of life, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Alleluia.